Shubhendu here. We will start with the section 14 of Indian Evidence Act in this video, and this is in continuation of our series of Indian Evidence Act. All the previous sections you will find in the playlist of this channel, or the previous section 11 you might find the link here on this video. So let's go to section 14. The heading of the section 14 is fact showing existence of state of mind or body or bodily feeling. So the very heading is very clear that sometime what normally happens is you want to show in a trial that a person was in a state of mind. For example, he was angry, he had a particular intention, he had a knowledge, or there are words which is stated in this section. So you want to show the emotions of the person during the commission of offense. So if there is a, to set the liability, sometime in criminal law, there's a principle called mens rea. Mens rea, where the state of mind is taken consideration, motive, preparation, and motive, preparation, and intention of the person, basically. So to have the offense, whether he had a particular intention or a particular motive to commit the offense, thereby have the liability. That's one of the part of the criminal law. Even in the civil wrong or in IPC, there are section 111 where it's talk about in section 239 it's talk about counterfeiting. And counterfeiting, when the offense of counterfeiting is done, or there will be a liability of counterfeiting only if you have a knowledge that you are dealing in the counterfeited notes. Counterfeiting means you are creating a parallel currency or parallel document. Sorry, parallel currency. So that's what counterfeiting means in 239 of IPC, and in 239 of IPC, and in 111 of IPC, as I said. It's talk about the liability which is attached to a person during whether he have a he is in possession of stolen goods or not. So if you have a knowledge of the fact that the goods which is in your possession is stolen, then the liability under 111 of IPC is stated or is made out. In 239 of IPC, you should have the knowledge about the counterfeiting. Then 239 IPC is made out. So in a lot of offenses, this is the prime criteria or parameter on which offense is made out. So at the same, there must be a provision in Indian Evidence Act which should say that a particular state of mind or state of bodily feeling or state of body should be the part of whether there should be a provision which allow you to give evidence in the same. So yeah, so let's read the section 14. Fact showing existence of state of mind, state of body, and bodily feeling. Fact showing the existence of state of mind such as intention, knowledge, good faith, negligence, rashness, ill will, goodwill, goodwill towards a particular person, or showing the existence of state of body or bodily feeling are relevant when the existence of any such state of mind or body or bodily feeling is an issue or relevant. So let's curl out the from we have intention, we have knowledge, and then we can have ill will or goodwill or negligence. Or intention, knowledge, ill will, good faith, rashness, negligence, basically, towards a particular person, or showing the existence of state of body. Now it will show the state of mind or state of body. Now these are very subjective words. What do you mean by intention? What do you mean by knowledge? Ill will, goodwill, negligence. So we will get into illustrations and try to understand what illustration states. So, for example, let's say there is a you're a dog owner or any kind of pet which is ferocious in nature, and you are owner of the same, and you know that this dog or this pet have already attacked different person, and now that same pet attacks the person called X. Since you have a knowledge about the same, so the knowledge about the fact that it has already bitten or had attacked earlier persons will be a relevant fact. Any document or any witness regarding the same fact can be produced in court, and that fact will be considered as a relevant fact according to Section 14 of Indian Evidence Act. Okay. So let's go by one illustrations. Okay, explanation says that this every criteria which I've already stated should be related to a particular issue now or relevant fact. It should be, they all should be related to a particular issue. What is issue? We have already in section 3 we have seen what is fact and issue. In section 2 we have seen what is issue. Or if you go to CPC order, I guess 14, where issue is defined. Issue is something which is, let's say, which is asserted by one party and denied by another party, right? Then only issue is created, right? So asserted by one party and denied by other party, denied by other party, and this will relate to what? If you remember in section 3, this will relate to something called existence or non-existence of liability, or we either have liability or we have right or we have disability. Well, we have other things like duty, power, and those are jure postulates you will be aware of, or we will cover in some other video. So, existence of liability or right or disability. If that fact related to any liability or any right or any disability, then that fact, if that fact is asserted by one party and denied by, if that fact is asserted by one party and denied by another party, that will become a issue. Now, with that, and any fact which is connected to issue, any fact which is connected to issue, only those facts which are connected to issue will be considered with relation to state of mind or state of body or state of bodily feeling. For example, one person is always angry. Let's say people say Mr. A is always angry, but the question was whether Mr. A was angry at the time of murder or not. So it should be related to the issue in hand, issue in fact. So whether it's related to crime or whether related to any offense, whether before or after he was in that state of mind or not, that is important. Not generalized. It should be targeted. It should be specific to what? Specific to the issue. Okay. So let's go to illustration. There is one more explanation saying that it should be related to the first explanation which I've just explained. Second explanation, previous conduct of accused is very important, because obviously as soon as there is a previous history, you can always say that he had a knowledge about the same, because knowledge is one of the part of, you have to remember this, intention, knowledge, good faith, ill will, goodwill, negligence, rashness. Seven of them. Let's go to illustration A. See, these are illustration you can only learn. A is accused of receiving stolen goods, right? So now the question in the whole thing, whether which facts will be involved. Fact that at the same time he was in possession of other stolen goods is relevant. fact that he had a knowledge about the fact that this goods are stolen from somebody is also relevant. So both the facts. Second, already discussed, if you have ferocious dog, you already knew that this dog is ferocious in nature, and still you have allowed the dog to go out and bite people, which means you were negligent. In the case of in recent days, there is a coronavirus, right? All over the world, everything is shut down. When you know that you have symptoms, or there might be symptoms that you might have coronavirus, the best part is to make sure that you should be in your home. Right, you should not travel, or you should not go to different gatherings. Any person who's going to different gatherings or traveling, they're being negligent because they have the knowledge of the fact. They have the knowledge of the fact that they have symptoms. So there is a possibility. So this knowledge is itself become a fact, a relevant fact to be considered in case of improving the negligence. Right. Same that is related to the current situation, but in section illustration C is related to dogs. A sues B for the damage done by a dog of B, which knew. I'm reading here this part. This one. A sues B for damage done by dog of B, which knew to be ferocious the fact that dog had previously bitten XYZ and that had made complaint to B are relevant, right? The question whether A is acceptor of bill of exchange, knew the name of the payee was fictitious. Bill of exchange like check, draft, DD. So if you know that the person who's making this check or DD is fictitious, means a person do not exist, is just a made up name. In that situation, the fact that A has accepted other bill drawn in the same manner before they could have been transmitted to him by payee if the payee is relevant. I mean the fact, the whole fact is relevant, okay? E, defamation is related to ill will, right? A is accused of defaming B by publishing a impression impute. Well, you understood the basic criteria, right? So if anything which is related to knowledge, if anything which can prove the ill will, in this condition is proving the ill will. So they had a fight, and then A publishes something for B against B. So since they have already had a fight, can prove the ill will. And since it's a ill will, the fact is related to ill will. That's why under section 14 of Indian Evidence Act, section 14, it will be a relevant fact. Remember these illustrations. When they come in exam, they will just ask you, this thing is related to which section? You just have to say section 14. Anything which is related to body, mind, state of body, state of mind or feeling will be section 14. Okay, goodwill, example of goodwill, that I got into a business with a person called A, thinking that he's a good person. I've also, and then I recommended person A to C. I'm a B, let's say I'm a B. So I've recommended the services of A to C. C got the services from A. And in the whole thing, A is a fraudulent. But at the time of getting into business with A, I thought he was he is not a fraudulent person. He's a correct person. In that case, the fact that I thought that A is a nice person is a goodwill, in a good faith. Henceforth, the whole fact will be relevant. The question is whether A has a guilty of cruelty towards B is very important, because all the domestic violence cases section you will use the section 14 to make the facts relevant and make them relevant, so that they can be considered for admission. We will see from the section 17 onwards what do you mean by admission or admissibility. Question is whether A has a guilt has been a guilty of cruelty towards B, his wife. That question will be also considered. A question is whether A death was caused by poison, statement made by during his illness as his symptoms are relevant. So if doctor says there are symptoms of poison, obviously those statements are relevant. So these are the illustrations. Basically you understood the point. It's all related to state of mind and state of body and state of bodily feelings. Obviously, we will just add few case laws. If you go to any regular text, you will find these case laws. stating that if, for example, Rawson versus Hegel, Hegel, okay, so basic ferocious dog and everything. So you can find the basic case laws, and in this section, this thing is only important. Okay, again, a very simple, straightforward section. In the next video, we will cover next important sections. For now, that's the wrap up on this video. Please share, subscribe, keep watching, and if you have any confusion, you can always comment so I can comment back. Okay, thank you very much.